So welcome to COSI. I'm Elisa, I'm one of the librarians here, and Kimberly's also another librarian. So we at the library host these conversations on social issues to provide a space for students to talk about these issues and express their freedom of speech. So just be aware and respectful of each other's different perspectives and viewpoints. Respectful, and we also have a lot of books and plenty of ebooks and e-resources here at the library. These are related to the topic today, so you can take a look at those and take them home if you'd like. And we also invite you, if you have a topic that you would like to discuss for a future session in spring, we'll be scheduling those soon. So any topic that you'd like, feel free to talk to me or Kimberly if you're interested. And then at the end of this discussion, we'll be handing out a really brief survey so you can give us feedback on this session and what you'd like to see in the future. Next Thursday, we'll be hosting filmmakers Sarah Samudre Salcedo and Hassan Salcedo, as well as representatives from the Duwamish tribe to discuss their documentary Promised Land. And they'll also be discussing tribal recognition and the Duwamish and Chinook treaty rights. So it'll be a really interesting session. Today we have Ricardo Leyva, Puebla, Dean of Student Development, and he's taking student input on how to move forward with the student-led media here on campus.
Well, thanks. I am so grateful to see these many faces here. How many of you are students at Central? Awesome. This is so cool. Thank you so much. I'm honored that you came and engaging into this conversation. I had this year, Christina, who is our officer, executive officer for communication, and is responsible to gather the committee for communications on campus, so it's a student leadership. She was not able to come today, so she let me know that, and so I'm sending her regrets on your behalf, since she's your student leader representative, that you can bug and give detailed of whatever issues that you want to have communicated to the rest of the team and to the campus as a whole. So her regrets, but part of the responsibility that we hold, or she holds really, is the publications. Sort of having that conversation and discussion. We have had at Central for a number of years, going back to 1966, a campus newspaper. So how many of you knew that it went back? Good, so almost a third of you here. So that's really great, right? And so the question that we have in this venture is that we're sort of in transition. And we're looking, this conversation is really also about getting feedback from you, the students, as to what do you foresee happening with, like what would you like to see happen. I want to, just as a conversation starter, how many of you read a newspaper print in the last week?
From school or like you read a newspaper?
Pardon?
Like the regular newspaper or the school?
Like a regular newspaper, yeah, like a paper. Yeah, newspaper at school, we don't have it. So I would say about six of you, if I saw the hands correctly. How many of you read some kind of news that was not in the printed form? Okay, so almost 80, 90% of you, right? How many of you listened or viewed other forms of news other than the paper and or electronically, let's just say that, not necessarily on TV. Okay, so the numbers go down a little bit. So it's just from this unscientific raising of hands, it seems from this experience of this crowd here is that most of you are looking for or look at news feed from electronic means or venues, right? Did I kind of gather that fairly correct? So this is the kind of questions that we're holding as seeking information from that perspective. holding that question to us as to how do we proceed. The paper's been around for 66. We have noted that there are sections or containers or what do you call those, newspaper, whatever, boxes?
The newsstands.
Newsstands, thanks, my English is sometimes. The English escapes me sometimes, so pardon me. English is my second language, by the way. So that there are papers in there and they've been around forever and they're still stacked. So nobody really took a lot of those papers and now they're old, so people are probably looking at, oh, is this useless? So something we need to do is go ahead and clean this up. So the question is, how do you see the newspaper, the paper which would be the student's paper, moving forward? Would it be a printed form? Would it be something that's electronic? Would it be a combination where there is visual and or auditory? With us today is one of the students, I'll have him introduce himself, who is working on a podcast. It's a form of publication. Wanna say who you are?
What's going on, you guys? My name is Columbus. I'm the vice president of the podcast committee. The president's actually not here, he got class. And so basically what we wanted to do with the podcast was kind of like shine positivity, what's going on in the community, you know? Like one thing that we noticed in the world is like it's a very hard time to just be like, you know, yourself and like open. So like one thing that we try to do with the podcast is like spread positivity. Like if so-and-so got a scholarship, you know, highlight that, highlight some of the things going on in the community, and like really put a spotlight on like the Seattle culture, you know what I mean? And so I feel like trying to bring the community back to Seattle Central Community College, pretty much.
So that's something that the students actually put together last year, got a little bit of funding this year to make it happen. And so if you're interested in podcasting, this is...
It'll be on iTunes if anybody wants to listen to it, too. We got it on iTunes now.
So, so way of introductions, that's sort of our purpose here. Any questions? Yes?
We're just going with Studio 104.
Because it's Studio 104. Does anybody know where the studio is on campus? Where the room is? Where it's over in the Broadway Edison Performance Hall on the first floor in this room 104. It's a really cool space. It's huge. That sounds space and all that stuff.
If anybody is, like, we did want to get involved or, like, you know, just wanted to, like, had a story to share, I could take down your emails and then we could send you, like, meeting times and stuff. If that's something that's interesting.
Right. So, thanks for bringing the copies. Appreciate it. I'm going to go ahead and hand these up to you if you could take one and then pass the stack. We'll start there and then we'll start over here. So this is a draft because I'm so new to the campus, and even though I'm familiar with Central for eons ago, the bottom of this, well, the top portion of it gives you a legacy that there are advisors that have been present to guide and direct the students when they do have that publications editorial board. The second section of this are the awards that the newspaper had received while it was the Collegiate, which was originally the original paper, and then it became the Central Circuit in 2009, and the nominations that they have received. And then the last section in this is the Washington Administrative Code. Student government, as well as student publications, student rights and responsibilities, all governed by the state rules and regulation and the district. So the district of our colleges also writes those up, and you can find them at online. If you go to our district and sort of do a search, you'll find all of those rules and regulations. These are specifically pertaining to publications, student publications. And as you can see, just on the first point here, is that primary purpose for student publication is to promote free and responsible discussion of campus and community issues. Bam, right? There you have it. So on the basis of this, and I'll let you kind of look at it for a couple of minutes and review it without me talking to you. But go ahead and take a look at it.
Can I see one of these?
Oh, yes. There you go. Thank you. So, any questions around any of what you've looked at so far?
Is the Board of Publications already established here at the school?
The Board of Publication that is appointed by the president of the college, there are names from the previous, but we have not reestablished that one affirmatively for this year. We postponed the newspaper, which is still in existence, so we haven't gotten rid of the paper. It's still in existence. We postponed it or sort of put it in a dormant state for these two quarters so that we could get some feedback. We held two forums in the fall, which were not attended, I'm sorry to say. So I'm really thrilled that all of you are here because it's like, yay! We got the voice of the students to share with us. And so those were the two. We're doing this, and then we're going to be doing a survey that we can get further feedback. So once that gets done and we know what direction we're going, then we'll reestablish that board and then begin looking at the editorial board, because you have the publications, you know, the board, which is the staff, student, and faculty. And then you have the editorial piece, which is what the students are going to be running. All of these different mediums, whatever we end up having. Other questions? Yes.
So, on point four, the last sentence says that student editors shall be free to develop their own editorial policies with these guidelines. Do you know if our school has, you know, created its own specific policies?
Yes, so we have the old one. There are some updates that are needing to be brought forth to the group. And once that's done, then, but there's a draft, let's just say at this point, that needs to be affirmed by the student, whoever the students are. Other questions? Good questions. Great. So that being said, time for you to speak your mind, give us some feedback. So the question is, where do you see, you know, any kind of publication going? What would you like to see happen?
Yes, sir. So I think that it'll be important to have both digital and a printed form of paper. The printed form being more, I assume, for our immediate community. Because just as a campus, I feel that we, you know, as a campus, we have a responsibility to our immediate community to do what we can to better the community and to take in their voices. And I feel the printed form is the best way to show to a lot of people who don't have access to digital forms of media, you know, to show them that we are doing what we can for our community.
So you're saying that the printed form would then serve to do the outreach outside of the campus?
Yep.
So question around that. And that is, in some of the more current ways of doing things, is that there's a printed, but the printed is more truncated so that people then have access to where else to look. So that we don't have a full on paper, let's say, but we have a printed format that says for further information, go here. And so that expands sort of the discussion. And still people have an idea of what's going on. How does that, I mean, that's something that's been floating. What does that sound like?
Well, I think one key thing that you just said was the access for people that don't have access to technology.
Right.
So I think that that is pretty key. And I don't know how you could account for that necessarily if it was a smaller version that was then expanded by digital media.
Yes.
Thinking about people's attention span, if I was reading something and it was like, oh, but for the rest of it, go here, I'd be like, not why? Why didn't I just get it all now? But I like it, I understand, like it makes sense, but maybe like, I guess, possibly swap, like, you know, like
every so often you have a full on printed. And
or like putting the like most, I guess, influential pieces digitally instead of cutting it out printed. But I don't know, I just like the physical newspaper so much, so that's kind of like my personal.
Yeah. So the digital would be more expansive.
Or pieces that didn't get into the printed, like couldn't fit, somebody put a lot of time into, but it just, for whatever reason, can't be put in printed, got to go on to digital.
Yeah.
Say that again. I'm sorry.
So if there's, say a lot of pieces are done and there's a lot of news going on and it cannot fit on the printed or we can't do that many pages because of budget, what have you, then it can go into digital. So that way somebody's hard work is still being seen and heard. And so not so much that you would share half a story in the printed and then say go to the digital, but more so an overflow of stories and information.
I know that there are a lot of students who don't have their own computers and then spend time in the library working on homework and using these computers, and I just see it as being more difficult to say, like, if you want to access this, it's online, when they're already kind of consumed with other work that they have to do. So I think it's a little more fair to have a printed version that people can pick up and like pass around and share with other people.
And at your leisure too, like, you know, at my high school, we had people, like, the day that the paper would come out, people were literally standing in the hallways handing it out to people.
Yeah.
And I think that that's cool because then you can literally take it, shove it in your bag, and then once you get home, you finish your homework at school, you're done in the library, you can, like,
or on the bus.
Yeah, wherever. Yeah.
I have two hands back here. Here and then.
I used to work for Center Circuit as a writer before, and we have practiced doing that, like standing in, you know, halls and distributing papers. But literally no one actually comes to you and, like, they don't even take the newspaper. So I feel like, what would be the way, like, you know, you go out there and you're like, we used to, like, go out there and distribute papers and no one actually would kind of pick it. So.
So that were, yeah, and those of you, and I'll get to you about Columbus, but those of you who speak to the printed part of it, were you the ones that raised your hand about reading paper?
Yeah.
So I'm trying to gauge, because what you're saying is that people didn't even pick it. Okay.
Just to follow up on what they're saying about making it more accessible, I don't know how doable this would be, but is there any way we could have, like, a live broadcast of the podcast, like, in the atrium or something, so that, like, while people are eating, we could just have, like, news just playing, like, it doesn't have to be super loud, but, like, something just playing in the atrium while people are eating, you know? Like, whether it be, like, some kind of, like, local music or, like, some kind of, like, news or, like, whatever.
Yes, sir.
So, my thoughts on the digital versus printed. I think they're two different kinds of media. For example, if you go, you know, New York Times has its printed format. If you go on New York Times website in the last year, 2 years or so, they've really started to push the boundaries of what can be expected from digital media. There are a lot of articles that are more interactive. They make great use of graphics that wouldn't you know, make their point in printed form. And I think there's a huge opportunity there for somebody who, you know, has, you know, one foot in journalism or journalistic tendency and another foot in graphic design or web development or programming or something like that. So I think I would hope that we wouldn't miss out on both opportunities there if there's interest.
So if I understand what you're saying is that as looking at the digital aspect of things, that it's a little bit more than just a digital printed, the experience that you have had with New York Times, right?
Yeah, New York Times specifically, that's just one example.
Right, the example there is that it's interactive, and you said a slew of things that I totally missed.
Oh, it's there's just more opportunity for experimenting in the way that we present information, knowledge, press.
Do you have comments so people can leave feedback? It's shareable on Facebook, so people can send them to their friends, like with
There's that aspect too.
And I think if I'm hearing you correctly, that you're saying this will also give people in graphic art department or in development in our school an area to practice and hone their skills.
Yeah. So this is a pretty open frontier right now. There are a lot of things that haven't been explored. In terms of what you can actually do with web design, as access to the internet becomes more ubiquitous, as the sophistication of web design has evolved over the last decade or so, this is something where not only can we, you know, be a part of that, but we can actually push the boundaries and experiment with new ways to, you know, present the news and more specifically news. Even if we're not, you know, pushing this envelope. It's you know, taking that and applying it to things that we care about locally.
Also, it's an opportunity you can put links to other things. So say like the podcast, you can say here, click this link and it'll bring you directly to where you can access the podcast, or click this link and you can view a whole gallery rather than trying to print a bunch of images.
Yeah. And somebody else had their hands up. I know it's so you before me. Okay. I'll get right to you after my comment. So one of the things, as you all know, one of the pieces that is actually needing, I think I need to add some processing out loud here, so pardon me, needs to be added to the story here of the timeline and history of the paper is that at one point there used to be a journalism program here at Central, as there was at South, as there were in other campuses and institutions, and those are going to the very few places around the country that hold those kinds of programs. So because there was a journalism program here, which Jeb Wyman, who's on the list of advisors, used to be an advisor for the paper, it was a feed to the paper. Not having a journalism program, it's made it, I think, very challenging for the paper in the recent past. Since the demise of that program. And so this comment brings to mind that one of the benefits of doing something like this is that we have programs that can indeed feed into, like our graphic design, like our web, that those kinds of programs then can have and allow for an influx of students who then could help, you know, generate artistically, practical, you know, expression of the work that they're learning in the classroom. So that has come up as part of the conversation. Yes?
I was just going to say that, keeping in mind that with this, we're going to be like kind of hitting a refresh button.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like being optimistic about like how we would get it out to people, and I think that not only, like for the physical copy, like not only doing things inside, but doing things like outside of school, like around the neighborhood, I think would be really beneficial, as well as I think there's, people rely too much on leaving things and expecting people to find them. And I think that like physically going into classrooms, like, I mean, I know that I have professors that I have made bonds with, and if I was like, hey, can I spend 3 minutes in your class this week just to just review the paper, and they'd be like, yeah, whatever, I don't care. You know, so I think that there's ways that like you kind of have to be optimistic and you kind of have to realize that if we're going to do this, all of the effort.
You have your hand up here.
So I just wanted to say, I think it's important to have both forms, digital and printed. And I think what the printed would also provide on top of, just access for the community. One of my fears is that digital wouldn't, people wouldn't seek it out. Printed, it's there, it's physical, it's visible, people are gonna pick it up. And then I also feel that it's something that students especially would take more pride in, to have a physical, newspaper that you could see your name printed on, that you could, if it gets an award, you could put it up on your wall, things of that sort. So I think it's important to have both digital and printed, but I think the printed is especially important in the sense of community, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So just to draw off of your point about expanding beyond our little, the school sphere of community, I think there have been a lot of missed opportunities in not having a voice for the students and, sort of this lens to focus national issues with stories from students and stories from around the neighborhood. There are opportunities to talk to people here who, I know some students who traveled out to Standing Rock and protested there instead of the protesters as veteran supporters. There are issues with student homelessness and even homeless vets here who I think if we're not telling those stories, we don't have an outlet for that. First of all, who's going to tell them? Second of all, it's bearing witness for them and focusing on their stories.
Yeah, there's definitely a commitment to continue publications in whatever format it ends up being for that very reason. And as you look at the rest of those points at the bottom of the page, I mean, it's about creating a voice for the students to address all kinds of issues. So there is definitely that commitment.
Yeah,
so I had it here, and then back here, and then back here.
On that, in a time of uncertainty, I think that this is a good way for people to feel like they have an outlet for all these issues that are going to continue to happen. I mean, we're in the first few days, and there's been lots of different things. And also, it will give leaders a chance to see the paper and know what students are feeling about, and those are the leaders that can make changes that need to happen. But my note was going to be on the print digital controversy or discussion. I do believe that we should have both, but also if print is an issue, whether for budget or for waste purposes, it's not like we couldn't say, okay, let's try this for 2 months and then let's go back and let's count, like set a little group that the people who distribute those papers in whatever areas you hand them out, then you go back and you count how many were left over at the time of our next paper, and then you can say, okay, we're only doing 20% of our print, that's a waste of resources and a waste of for our environment. Or you could say there's 80% or 60% gone and that's worth it.
Yeah.
So you can always come back and readdress it.
I agree.
Good point. I think we have Columbus.
Oh, okay. So I had like a two-part question. Real quick. Would you want to be a part of the podcast?
Yeah, let's talk after.
Michelle, I just had to throw that out there. And then the second one was, I just had a quick question for everybody. If we were to get a Seattle Central app, how many people would actually download it, and what would you guys want to see on it?
Like a phone app that would include, tie into
it would tie into like all kinds of things.
Like
calendar events. Sorry. Yeah.
So
answer the question, I guess,
The app idea is cool because I see it as being like, there's seattlecentral.edu where you can go to register for classes and figure out if there's a snow day, but it's not like you're going there as a source of entertainment. And so if we had an app that we could like kind of market well and get students to download, where we had a digital version of the paper that, and the podcast and whatever else you want to add, that might be a really cool kind of digital version.
Great.
I just had a question about the budget. Like, where does the budget come from? Where does the money come from to fund the paper and these efforts? Mm-hmm. And also, how does that? What kind of challenges do you feel you're up against with regard to the budget? And have you been in the past?
So the funding comes from student SNA fees. So the student SNA is the one that provides the funding for. And are you familiar with SNA fees? So you pay them every quarter.
Yeah.
So you're paying into programs and activities, clubs and student organizations, events, speakers, funding that you put out every quarter. So annually, and I'm forgetting how much it is here. I haven't figured out where I can find that information. But I will before the end of the quarter. So there is that funding. The funding, any restrictions in the funding around that particular area or any area within student leadership, the student programs and activities, et cetera, is based on the number of students that enroll. So we will, if the enrollment continues to go down as it is at Central, we will be impacted by that reality because we're receiving less money than we had received, you know, a couple years ago. And that will reduce the dollar amounts that we get for all kinds of student sort of activities and events. So, yeah. Does that answer your question?
Part of it.
Okay, what was the other part?
So the other part was, what are the challenges do you feel?
The challenges in regards to student numbers. And so if that does happen, and we do have to look at within the next year what that reduction is going, how that reduction is going to impact.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't set that meeting up with our business office yet. And our admin assistant, Carrie Mills, who's been around forever and has a lot of information. But eventually it will probably impact, but again, it depends on the number. So we could end up having, you know, an increase in student full-time enrollment, and that could then switch things around a little bit.
So have the printed papers then been like paid for to an external printer, or because we used to do them on site here?
Yeah, we'd have to contract out whoever it is that does any of the printing. So that all of that funding, when we look at the possibility of not doing full on printing as in the past, it would allow then for more students to benefit from funding of the paper or the publication. Because then we can move the money that would normally cost to print out all of that. I like the idea about testing, whoever said it over here, and seeing, you know, how many really get put out there and get taken, right, to doing that sort of surveying. Because the money that gets spent could then be sort of channeled towards students. The idea is that when students write or do a story or submit a photo that is journalistic in nature, whatever that might be, whatever the editorial group wants to publish, that individual gets paid for it. And so there is that benefit to students that are involved in writing and presenting on whatever publication we end up with. And so what we've been looking at is that if we move into a much more digital format, less into the printing, we'd save money, and then the students end up gaining more out of that experience, because then you can spread the wealth. That's the other piece that we're looking at, is having more across campus participation and involvement, so that it's not just a small group of students and the editorial board that are the ones that write, but to really encourage broader engagement from students to write and submit work that can then be published in some way. They would in turn get paid.
Like independent classes can have like contests or some sort of entry format.
It could be anything, yeah. It could be let's say that the English department, you know, has this write and then submit, and then one of those individuals gets it. It'd be awesome. So we would get more and more engagement of students interested in you know, doing that work in whatever format, again. But that's the idea, that if we're able to figure this out, then one of the benefits is that more students would benefit from the time. Because they get paid. I mean, it's that kind of program. Yes?
I just wanted to weigh in briefly on a trial period for the printed format.
Yeah.
I think, you know, assuming everything gets to that stage, the trial period should be longer than just a couple of months or so.
Yeah,
also,
I agree.
Yeah, we need to commit ahead of time to
kind of be planned out and figured out.
Yeah, a couple of quarters or maybe the whole year where we give the paper time to establish credibility for itself and
right. Yeah,
no,
I would agree. It would have to be more in depth.
Oh yeah.
A broader sense so that we can get more feedback.
Something that comes to mind is that with like the budget and like less students attending Seattle Central, I think that there's a huge stamp on Seattle Central, like a stereotype of like if you come here you don't have a social life. There isn't that big of a sense of a community as if you went to UW or SC or like a 4-year university.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's because students don't have a way to communicate with the rest of our
each
community.
Other.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that, obviously over an extended period of time, if this worked out, I think that in a perfect world that the paper could really impact and like...
Could create community.
Yeah.
We're hoping that the phone app, just as an FYI, the Associated Student, the Services and Activity Board did authorize to get a phone app. And so we're in the middle of negotiating that with a company called Ulala. So I don't want to Google it and look it up. And so South Seattle has it. South Asset University of Seattle is using the app as well. So check it out. Send me an email, tell me what you think. But we are trying to do that so that there is that sense of community and engagement
mm-hmm.
with students. It'll have ways in which students who are wanting to get information on, you know, whether it's rental or a book for sale or that they're interested in a particular club, like podcast, and, you know, they can kind of get at that community sense. So here, and then, did I get you the last time?
No, you can go.
I keep thinking that I got you, but I haven't.
So the school president will be appointing the representatives for the board, correct?
The college, for which board?
The publications board? Yeah, the publications
board. Yeah, so the publications board is a requirement, right, of the state rules and regulation. And that is not intended to determine what gets printed necessarily,
okay.
Right? That is a governing body to make sure that whatever publication system we create, they're overseen to make sure that that is run the way it's supposed to.
So the students would still have full direction if we wanted to have?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Whatever, as long as the students are staying within the norms of journalism, what are some of the other issues that might come up, where, you know, honest and truthful information is being provided so that they're not, you know, there's not a creation of some accusation that isn't true. I forget what you call that, but that sort of thing.
I guess my question would have been for the lady that left, but I was just going to ask, what was it about the circuit that, like, what do you think it was about the circuit that made it so students didn't want to read it?
Yeah.
Like, because I know when I first seen it, there was like a stack by the windowsill, and I just seen like, it looked like a bunch of flyers at first. I didn't even know they were like magazines.
So there wasn't... So I have no idea why people read or didn't read it. I know that a lot of folks didn't.
Okay.
So from the feedback that I've got, it wasn't as popular for whatever reason, and I don't know. And I think that that's maybe part of the conversation that, or the questions that we need to be asking. It's like, what made it worth reading or not?
Yeah, could we even like talk to the ex-workers, I guess, or whatever you call it?
People who weren't here, I mean, not
just the bystanders, people who decided to read it, not to not read it, that would be interesting to find out and ask people who weren't writing it, because then we get the outside, like, true perspective, because I know a lot of people in the paper were, like, so put their hearts in it, but, you know, everyone else doesn't really know that.
Mm-hmm. So, I think...
Question
here,
then. I want to hear from the first.
Okay, so I did read it.
Good.
It's just going to be kind of brutal. It wasn't very attractive. Articles weren't great. There was some grammar issues, some broken English. It wasn't hard-hitting. It wasn't, like, juicy information. And it also, again, it looked like a newsletter. And I think we can make it way more attractive.
Yeah.
I think that we should get some graphic design students to help. I think we should work on finding out what students are interested in and maybe do some sort of survey or get feedback first off on what like people would read about and want to hear about and then work around that. It just, to me, like I would pick it up and try to read it and was just so like kind of used to it.
Like randomly, what would you want to see on it? Like what are some of the things you would want to read about?
Something we met the other day and we're discussing setting one up, but something I was thinking about was like the like intersectional feminism, which has been brought up a lot after the Women's March. I know by the time this publishes it won't be such a topic, but I've realized that a lot of people don't understand what that means, and I know there are students who really care about it. I think it's a school that we really pride ourselves on activism, and there's kind of a rebellious nature to a lot of people here, people really interested in social sciences, and I think we could put more of a social justice theme into it. And also we talked a lot about getting voices of a bunch of students, and obviously like if somebody has an interview and their picture's in it and they're talking about something that they care about, they're gonna pick it up, they're gonna show it to their friends, they're gonna show it to friends that don't go to the school. I think we should get more people involved, even if it's just for small like questions.
Mm-hmm. Check back with me.
Okay.
We do want to do a survey. If you're interested in helping with that, I would love the help. So I think you're
in. I thought a lot about this because I was going to be on the editor. I was going to be a writer, and so I had several different themes that I just think are really important for students. And one of those, just the newspaper itself, is an opportunity for people to literally reach from where they are as students into their careers because they're able to express their voice. And boy, that really looks good for a student to be able to be on the newspaper, sharing articles about what they've done. It's a really, I believe, a real bridge for giving people a voice, just like the radio is, just like the podcast opportunity is, because these are the things that in this day and age, to become current, you've got to be expressing yourself. And so I'm really excited about some of my ideas were to do interviews, actually literally do interviews of different people, for example, on the Board of Trustees, understand the student body versus the faculty versus, you know, the board and how all of that fits together, helping people understand possibly legislators that would like to connect in and projects that professors are working on to move legislation forward. I think it's a really cool idea. It was also, I've enjoyed just some of the free-for-all that, you know, people, you know, students really find their passion and they're able to talk about that. I think it's a wonderful thing as well. I see it as really, if even the Career Center could understand that this is a real opportunity for students to get their voice out there and understand how important it is in building their profession. You know, any kind of writer, any kind of researcher, any kind of person who wants a voice ultimately, it's a huge opportunity. And so really engaging that bridge, even the learning projects that Griffin does, Patty Gorman, Gorman does learning projects.
Oh, yes,
and
yes.
Just even, you know, documenting that kind of thing. But I just think it's a beautiful thing in a small school like this to be
so
able to have people have their own voice.
Yeah.
So
no, I think that it's been mentioned earlier that it would provide an opportunity for a lot of application of skills, putting it into practice.
Yeah.
And it, you know, so it's not just the graphic designer students, but the web designing students, but the writing students, those who are interested in you know, literature, social justice, social issues.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It, a newspaper, or whether it's electronic, digital, whatever, any kind of publication that exists, you know, the same thing with podcasting. Anything could provide a great venue for students to really put in,
and,
you know, some of that
and
experience.
And how professors understand the access to that, so that
yeah.
It's really bridged. It's huge.
Yeah, and
it's
I think that faculty and staff are aware now. There's three hands here, and let's start here and then go this way.
I would respond to what you were saying. I think it's a really good point. And you know, the second point, you know, states that this board shall serve as the publisher of all student publications and shall have the general authority over them. So you know, it just like this language just means that, you know, they can stop something from being published or, you know, approve something from being published. So I think it's a really good point, you know, about, you know, who can publish what on this paper.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, you know, to talk about grammatical mistakes in English, I feel it's really hard and unreal for, you know, anyone to expect a student who, you know, who doesn't have English as a first language to be, you know, crisp and clear and, you know, correct in every form and, you know, semantic when it comes to writing something in English. Also, like, you know, I feel like this publication should be multilingual because, you know, Central serves such a big community of students.
Yeah, and that's been brought up before about multilingual. I think that the challenge is having it set up so that editorially, if, you know, does everybody speak whatever language other than English we're going to use? And do we have the capacity to editorially, you know, review and make sure everything is in place? If you give me something written in Italian, I don't think that I can really, if I was a student and I have to review editorially, you know, that would be a little bit more of a challenge. But and in response to the sort of the expectation is this is a newspaper, and so the goal is that it does read well and it is properly written. Will there be no mistakes? I doubt that that will ever be the case, but that there is a standard by which people are going to be held to that is important to do so. Understanding that it would be great to have different voices in this, and it would be awesome to be multilingual. I'm not sure that the capacity of this paper would be able to reach that as much as I also wanted it. So we have here, here, here.
So I think that you're correct that we should have editing where there's somebody that goes back through and reviews it. Most newspapers have that, where you have a deadline, and when you get it in by that deadline, somebody can go through and search for grammatical any issues. And
that,
obviously
yeah.
There's stuff that will slip through.
Right,
but
and that's the editorial board.
Exactly.
So there is a group of students who will
that
review
be doing
and
that,
making
yeah.
Yeah, that happen.
Yep.
And I think that whoever was saying that it was not, you know, the
yeah, so I don't mean
so,
to like offend anybody. It just
no, no, it's
that's
I've heard that.
Yeah.
So that the most the most recent publications of the paper tended to fall short of a standard, and I think that was problematic. I'm just
yeah, gotcha. But my point was, we were discussing the differences of what didn't work in that last publication and what we should have in this one, and I like all the points that you brought up. But I also think, well, obviously we're in no short of juicy stories at the moment. There's a lot going on. So I think that's a given. But I also think that it's important to have some positivity. We have a lot of heavy stuff going on right now. And I think to keep stories, or at least include portions that have stories of unity and or humor and
yes.
Positive outlooks to keep people out of all this negative. On Facebook, it's negative. On communications, it's negative. On the news, it's negative. Let's make sure that we have some positivity shining
yes.
through.
Yeah.
Really good.
Yeah.
podcast.
So just how much time do I have to?
Willing and able to stay, we have the room till about one, but I also want to recognize that some people might have to get to class, so let's thank Ricardo for his time. Everyone who has been here contributing their perspective and their voices, we really appreciate it, and I think Ricardo has a little bit more time.
I do, and there were a couple more hands up. I'm willing to stay here for another 10 minutes. I think it was here, here, and then here. Okay.
I forgot what I was going to say originally, but just going off of what he said, even like the bilingual thing doesn't have to be one. You can just have one article, and I think that there are so many international students here. It's absolutely astounding how many and positive ways. But I think that that would really draw a lot of people in as well. And different languages each week or something. Just
I do think, and we're going into content of a paper as opposed to the question at hand. But I think that those are good. That's good feedback to provide. That if even in small doses, that it's manageable to do some translation. That might work. We may not do a whole article, but if we're able to do a poem, or if we're able to do, some short bit that really invites a multilingual approach to the paper, that's doable. So there may be ways in which we can guide the student, to consider some of these comments or suggestions. So again, keep in mind that we're moving into content up, but I'd like to get more feedback around this topic. So here and then here.
So just real quickly, what, if any, policy changes have been put in place to prevent what happened in 2008 with the shuttering of the first paper?
Say that again now.
Sorry. So in 2008,
switch between one and the other.
Not to editorialize too much, but the locks were changed in the newsroom and everything was thrown.
I really have not. I mean, I was hoping
to
get a little bit more history around this stuff, but I found a CD of all of the, I think most all, I would say about 99% of all of the collegiate
printed.
In, they were digital ice. They were sent to the University of Washington, and they did a fish, the old, and those got turned into a digital format.
Right.
So I have those, and I'm trying to figure out, because we need to have them, we need to memorialize that in some way, put it in some
archive
of some sort, because that's the one thing that I have not. I'm a true believer in holding history, whether I like it or not, but being true to the history of whatever, it is.
Right.
And so having the papers and the history, whether fun or not fun, or maybe an interpretation that may not be 100% correct, but at least out there so that we can have that conversation. I have no idea what happened there, other than there was an apparent conflict in conversation, ideas, and tug of war around that. And so at whatever point that happened, I would say, so there was that tension between the previous paper or to the most recent, and then most recently, students, I understand, also had challenging experiences, because according to what I've heard, the most recent rendition, the circuit, this, whatever last year was, that there was tension there too, and it was from the editorial group of students that there was too much monopolizing of what was going to go out or not, that people were feeling as though they provided articles and weren't printed, and so whoever the people in charge of that particular paper were having difficulty, so there was an exodus of students from the paper because of the challenges that they were facing within, including the advisors that I'm out of here. So, those are tensions that happen. And I think that if we have a good, selfless, and I use that word strongly, board, publications board, which means that they're there to support the development of the students, and are not there to put their own self forward, that would probably be helpful. I'm not sure that we have done a good job with that, and that's my opinion, and I'm sticking to it. Get me in trouble if you wish, and I'm on camera saying it, so it's forever more in some place. So here, and then the last one.
So my last question for you is, what is the time frame that you guys are thinking
for? Yeah, so I'm hopeful that we will have something by the end of this quarter that we can move forward to and then establish it for the spring tour in whatever format we do, whatever combination we end up.
One of the things that I felt really important as the director of the student body, there's a real link between what the council, your council that has been elected is doing and connecting it with what's happening through the paper or through some kind of informational way so that people really see what these elected students are doing. It's a lot of stuff that
yeah.
We have. So somebody at the board level, they're corresponding within the paper to let the people know, the students know. I think it's a really fun opportunity.
Yeah, so the good tension, and I'd say good because I think it is the fact that, as you read on your the WAC, it is a student-run paper. So we're not supposed to dictate what goes into the paper. What we can say to the students is, these are the parameters by which you have to do whatever it is that you do. And those we can hold true to. But I cannot tell the students, no, you can't write about that. But I can say, okay, you're going to write about that. Have you thought through what the outcome of that is? Are you prepared for A, B, and C? Is it, you know, we can get into that. Is it fair? Is it accurate? All of those things. But we can't really
say. Well, I just see that it's a direct link.
No, it's always a link, because we're a community, so no matter what, we're going to be tied together.
And I'm not, I just am saying, I think that would be a really important.
No, I agree with you. I'm agreeing. Yeah. So, thank you so much for your input and for your thoughts and questions and comments. I really appreciate it. So we.